Let's check out our first reversing challenge in the desert of reversing, called Jumpy. If you haven't seen last video, you really should watch it, because we are about to read a lot of AVR assembler and we have to understand the AVR architecture a little bit. The description reads, "We really need access to this lab, protected with an Arduino-based access control system. Our operatives obtained the flash dump from a non-personalized engineering sample, but we are having trouble reverse engineering it." Ah, that is great. So, as we know, the .hex binaries we flash onto the board are personalized, or rather encrypted, so we can't disassemble them. But this challenge gives us a jumpy.bin file, which presumably is a non-personalized version, so not encrypted. I also wonder what the name Jumpy could mean. Will the program jump around a lot to obfuscate what the password is, or does it mean we have to use a jumper on some of the pins of the Arduino? Well, we will figure it out eventually. So let's load the challenge onto the board and connect to it via screen. We are presented with an input prompt, and when we send some data it says, "Better luck next time." Next we have a first look at the bin file. With file we see that it's not a standard executable file format like ELF, so it's probably basically a raw dump of the memory. We can also quickly check with the strings command if the correct input password is simply embedded in it. I had a little bit of hope for only 100 points, but it turns out it's not in there. The next steps I will present look like I had a straightforward plan, but in reality what followed were hours over hours of looking at stuff all over the place, trying to understand this binary, and there was a lot of frustration. It was the first time ever I had to reverse engineer AVR, and especially such low level hardware stuff. So let me give you a short list what I set up and explored, and afterwards I tell you how I ultimately solved it. First I was looking into how I could debug this, because static analysis is always a bit harder if you don't know what to look for. And I quickly found SimAVR and installed that and tried to run the binary. It took some time to understand how I can run it, ran into some issues with setting the frequency and a floating point exception that I had to track down, but in the end I figured out how to use the Simduino example, which basically simulates an Arduino board, so that's perfect. To use that, I had to convert the binary file to an Intel hex format like the Arduino would expect, and then I could actually execute it. It also starts a GDB server you can attach to with GDB, but it has to be a special AVR GDB build, included in the GNU AVR toolchain. With SimAVR, you can also use PicoCom to interact with the simulated UART serial interface, but there were countless of issues, more about that soon. I also checked out the binary with IDA. Luckily my IDA license can disassemble AVR, but if you look at the addresses, they increment by 1, even though the opcodes are actually 2 bytes. You see here the real address. So this was quite annoying to cross-reference with the debugging in GDB. Because I like Binary Ninja, I also installed a plugin somebody wrote for AVR, because it's not supported by default. And that also kind of works, at least it displays the addresses so I can work with them, but it's a very basic plugin and doesn't identify a lot of functions. Also doesn't really understand the interrupt table at the beginning. By the way, this here is an interrupt table. It's easy to guess because it's just a big list of jumps to somewhere else, and we can read in the datasheet which address is which interrupt. So for example, when the board is reset or turned on, the execution will start at 0. But you can have other interrupts triggered, for example from a timer. Very typical for an embedded system. Anyhow, while I used all these tools during my exploration phase and experimented with them, in the end I used Radare. I want to emphasize again, before I walk you through the solution, I had a lot of frustration with this. It will look kinda easy, but I don't even know how many hours and days I spent on learning AVR and getting things like SimAVR running. So don't be discouraged when you tackle a new platform or CTF challenge where you get stuck and have no idea what to do. I didn't have any idea either, but the satisfaction in the end from finally solving it after working so hard is worth it. So here's basically my line of thinking after I started to understand AVR disassembly and also generally the hardware platform. This challenge wants you to input a password over serial. In last video we have learned how that works on the low level. This means we want to look for locations where this special address C6 is written to or read from, because this is where single characters from the serial interface will be handled. We can open Jumpy with Radare 2, tell it that it is AVR, and then analyze it with AAA. With P capital D, we can print disassembly for a specific length. So we can simply print the disassembly of the whole binary and use the tilde, which is basically just grep, to filter lines that do something with C6. And we find here two lines that load that address into register R24. Let's have a look at these two locations. The first one is at hex EA. So we can print the disassembly of the function this address belongs to with PDF. Or we can also show a graph view with VV at that location. But I will stick with the linear view for now. We can also enable assembler description as comments, which are so helpful for reading AVR for the first time. So here you can see that hex C6 is moved into R24. And that's it. It doesn't load from that address, it just loads the value into that register. Here's another weird AVR thing that took a bit until I realized that. The value in R24 is moved into register 30, so now that register contains C6. And then whatever value is in register 18 is moved or stored into the memory location referenced by Z. We can check the datasheet of the Atmega again and read up about general purpose registers, and we learn that Z is simply referring to register 30 and register 31 combined. And 30 contains C6, so whatever is in register 18 will be written into the UART buffer register and sent out via serial. So, this is the location where one character is sent to the computer. Those registers XYZ make this so annoying to read until you can memorize which registers they refer to. Anyhow, let's check out the other location. Here we can basically see the same. C6 is loaded into register 24, which is then loaded into register 30, which is then used in the load indirect instruction to load the byte that is contained in the serial buffer. So this is where our input is read. We can also follow the cross-reference, which called this function, and find this here. Where, if we look at the graph, see that it apparently checks if the character is a carriage return or a new line, and if not, we'll read the next character. Cool, so that function seems to read the input line. So the password check can't be far away, but the issue is, this function doesn't have any xrefs. So no idea where this is coming from or where execution will go after it returns. So now I choose to debug this with GDB and SimAVR. First I start SimAVR, or to be more precise, the Simduino example, and use jumpy in the converted hex format. This will also spawn a GDB server. So now I can use the AVR GDB to connect to the server, and we can see that execution is still waiting at the start. We can now set a breakpoint at 2BA, which is just before loading the value from the serial buffer. I can then use PicoCom to simulate serial input and type a capital A, which will trigger the breakpoint here. Slowly stepping forward, and I see the 4-1, which is our character A. So that works. Well, not really. This is buggy as it turns out. After reading the first character, it will continue reading some rubbish in infinite loop, and I couldn't figure out why. If I would send a new line immediately, it would read that and continue, but it couldn't enter any more data. At this point, thank you so much, Vernu from IRC. That person created an issue on SimAVR and explained it. Turns out there's a bug where the emulator doesn't reset the flags that indicate new data arrived, thus it constantly thinks that the serial buffer is full and reads from it. This patch solves this. So, modifying the sources of SimAVR, recompiling it, and now it works like a charm. Now we can actually enter a longer string. So the breakpoint I've set here is immediately after reading the next character. So we can see that I entered the alphabet ABCDEF and so forth. We can continue until we read the carriage return from pressing enter. Now we can carefully single step forward, we go past the check for a carriage return and return from this function. So where are we returning to? Turns out Radare did not find this function, but that's not a problem, we can define a new one here. When we look at the graph view, we can immediately see a loop, and when the loop is done, it compares with hex D. I stepped through this, and it turns out it's basically counting the amount of characters of our input string, so I assume we need 13 characters for our input. If we look at what happens if this compare succeeds or fails, we see that when it fails it will load a value from SRAM, perform an OR on it, meaning that it will definitely set a 1 there, and then write this value back. In the case the compare would have been okay, it would not do that. I didn't immediately catch that when I first looked at this, but afterwards it's pretty clear that this will set an error flag. Basically, if you do something wrong with your input, it will set that flag and you failed. But even though our input will clearly fail eventually, we can step further and see where this function will return to. And it turns out, what is a price, it's also not a function Radara2 identified. We can immediately see that there is also a compare that looks pretty much like the one from before. If the compare fails, we set the error flag. And if we debug this step by step, we can see that this SRAM location 135 and 136 loads the letters H and I, then adds the ASCII value together and compares the result with D3. And this is our first big breakthrough on how the password is checked. If you continue this path, you will find more and more functions like this. All of those take two characters, add them together, and check the result. There are many same functions, just with different character offsets. And when you keep stepping, you also find a second kind of these, which multiply the ASCII values of two characters. Otherwise it's the same, it checks the result of the multiplication. So first step is to find all these blocks, which I did by printing a linear disassembly from the whole binary, copy it into Sublime, and used an ugly huge regex to find all the functions that have this pattern of loading two values into R24. Then I copied them into a new file and started cleaning them up until I have the important pieces extracted. Basically, we now know all the rules. These two characters have to have this sum, these two characters have to have this sum, these two characters multiplied have to have this result, and so forth. A super easy and perfect tool to solve this is using an SMT solver like Set3. I won't go into much detail as the video is already super long, but basically I just write a couple of constraints that express exactly that logic. The variable values represents our input character array, and I say the sum of character 7 and character 8 has to be D3. The multiplication of character 4 and 5 has to be hex122f. I write it all down and let Set3 solve this puzzle for me, and I get the string that follows all these rules. Give it to me. Wow! I was so happy when that popped up. I connected to the board, sent the password, and I get the flag. Another 100 points. Damn, this 100 point challenge was really hard for me. I don't even want to know how hard a 300 point challenge is.